The original Poltergeist is my favorite horror movie. To this day, it surpasses all others for me in its ability to create a realistically terrifying situation. Poltergeist is the brainchild of Steven Spielberg, as it came out of his desires to exorcise his childhood demons, taking some of the things that scared him as a kid living in suburbia and placing audiences smack dab in the middle of it. Spielberg has an uncanny ability to tap into the primal unconscious forces of the human mind that control many of our physiological responses. He was a master at crafting stories that affect people on a deeply emotional level. Before Poltergeist, he'd done it with his 1975 hit, Jaws. In the early 1980s, he began cooking up the story for Poltergeist in tandem with Tobe Hooper, whose film, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, had impressed Spielberg so much that he wanted to work with Hooper. Spielberg wrote a treatment and then hired screenwriters Michael Graves and Mark Victor to pen the screenplay. Unsatisfied with their draft, Spielberg reworked it himself, though this has been disputed by sources, claiming Spielberg had help from Kathleen Kennedy, Frank Marshall, Tobe Hooper, and up to 8 uncredited screenwriters in the eventual final draft. Regardless, Spielberg, Graves, and Victor were the only ones credited. At this point, it must be stated that I firmly believe Spielberg directed the film. Even though Tobe Hooper was credited, there is a mountain of evidence and testimony from many of the cast and crew that Spielberg, not Hooper, was responsible for the direction of Poltergeist. The primary reason is that Spielberg was in fact supposed to direct Poltergeist originally, but was prevented from officially getting the title of director by the Directors Guild of America. Spielberg was also prepping his other film, E.T., and guild rules would not allow him to prep one movie while directing another. So Hooper was given the task, basically being a stand-in, while Spielberg did most of the heavy lifting creatively. Whether or not people believe Spielberg really directed Poltergeist, it cannot be denied that his creative fingerprints are all over the film. And he did have a large part in crafting the story and wrote an eventual draft of the script, as well as being very active on the set and in post-production. So for all intents and purposes, Poltergeist is a Spielberg film. This entire analysis is based on this idea, so going forward I will be crediting Spielberg as the major creative force behind the decisions that resulted in the effectiveness of Poltergeist. While I'm sure Hooper contributed, and I mean no disrespect to the man, for simplicity's sake, I'm just going to refer to the film as Spielberg's going forward. Poltergeist is a very effective horror movie. It is very scary. One of its most effective methods of expressing horror is setting up the environment in such a way that creates an extreme contrast between what is perceived as normal and abnormal, so that the horror aspect is felt more strongly when it eventually occurs. Spielberg is a master at utilizing this technique. One of my major complaints about modern horror, especially supernatural horror, is that there just isn't a lot of contrast between the normal and abnormal. Characters are often established as problematic to the point where the horror is like an afterthought. There are, of course, exceptions to this, and I'm not saying that all supernatural horror movies have to use the same techniques, but there seems to be a modern trend that paints the world these stories take place in with such a depressing veneer that you really don't get a strong sense of dramatic escalation in a lot of these scenarios. Sometimes the normalcy in modern horror movies is already so annoying or off-putting, I don't really care as much when the horror aspect kicks in, making the journey less effective. Horror is about shattering innocence. But if things are already wrong, or not particularly innocent, it becomes harder to scare me. Or rather, the more you establish a brighter, more optimistic reality, the more difficult it becomes to watch that reality shatter. One of Poltergeist's most effective methods in expressing its visceral sense of horror is in its brilliant setup of the environment in which the horror will take place. The images in the opening credits is of an idyllic, suburban setting, where children, who are the most precious commodity of all and need the most protection, freely play and express themselves in the street with their bikes. The images are warm, comforting, and almost ridiculous in their normalcy. This is reinforced by composer Jerry Goldsmith's sweet, innocent, and beautiful music score. All the houses look the same, painted in warm, comforting hues. This sameness makes everything seem very inviting. There is security in that. Families are moving in. People are enjoying the safety and security suburbia offers. And this security and safety is about to be removed for one unlucky family. And the brilliant thing is that it could be any family. It could be many people in the audience. But how does Spielberg create a strong connection between the audience and the characters in the film? The movie does several things in its opening act to set up this world as a very normal, everyday, happy environment in which anyone in the audience would want to live. The neighbors are together watching a favorite American pastime, football. Lots of people like football. It's an American tradition that brings people together. It's a quick, effective way of drawing audiences further into the safe, comforting world of this movie. But this is kind of a male-dominated aspect and showcases Stephen, the father. The mother, Diane, makes her children's beds while singing a comforting song. Foreshadowing is something movies, especially suspense thrillers and horror movies, etc., rely on to create a creeping sense of danger in the minds of the audience, establishing that possibility that they are going to experience something terrible. The first thing that happens that hints that things are about to go wrong is Diane trips over her kids' roller skates. A harmless mistake, but the accident interrupts her singing, creating a tonal shift in the scene, which is deliberate in order to create anxiety in the minds of the audience. Another thing that happens in the same scene is that Diane realizes the children's bird has dropped dead out of the blue. This out-of-the-blue, seemingly trivial death of a bird is actually very important in foreshadowing that things are not what they seem, and that this warm, comforting environment is actually becoming dangerous and unpredictable. The death of the bird signals that the children's comforting world is about to be shattered, and they are going to be forced to grow up much faster and sooner than the parents would like. Another sign that things are becoming more and more dangerous and unpredictable is the television set in the Freeling house begins acting up, being switched to different channels because of an electronic malfunction having to do with the neighbor's remote. The comforting American pastime of football is being interrupted by some unseen force, a perfect symbolic representation of events to come. It seems trivial, but these subtle trivialities create anxiety and tension in our minds. This next bit is very interesting. As Diane goes to flush the bird down the toilet, notice the design of this space. Much of the bathroom is yellow, just like the bird. This bit of production design is completely deliberate and done in order for the audience to identify the death of the bird with the house itself. While this is completely subconscious and no one will think about it, a seed has been planted in our minds that this house is about to go through something horrible, just like the bird. Soon after, Robbie, the son, goes outside to check out the tree in the backyard. This is another subtle bit of foreshadowing. The tree is designed to look almost alive, with limbs coming out of it, and almost looks like it has a face. It is also completely devoid of plant growth, another deliberate design choice in order to give the tree more of an otherworldly appearance, a darker presence that eschews any sense of life. Another effective choice by the filmmakers is the casting of Carol Ann, the sweet-natured, innocent-looking cherubic child who was kidnapped. In this scene, she mourns the death of her bird with her mother. It is a scene designed to draw the audience into this sweet, innocent, loving family, to maximize the effectiveness of the horror later on. They are real people, paying respect to the dead. This presents the Freelings as thoughtful, good-natured people who don't deserve the horrors to come and who have the kind of strong family bond that will eventually be used to eradicate their ghost problem. This is contrasted with a lot of other supernatural horror movies, which seem to go out of their way to make the characters unlikable, so that any sense of empathy for their plight is difficult to come by. This shot is a continuation of Robbie's earlier encounter with the tree. The tree now looks even more sinister and alive than before, with the rain and lightning to give it texture. And the composition of the shot captures it in a more anthropomorphic, human-like pose. It looks more like a creature than a tree. Trees are supposed to be a comforting, idyllic part of suburbia, so this contrast is very striking and ramps up the anxiety in the audience. With a thunderstorm in the background, it is the first real moment of creepiness in the film. It is Spielberg slowly ratcheting up the tension, something he is extremely skilled at. Diane goes to tuck the children in, establishing a warm, familial bond between the children and their mother. Another part of the normalcy dynamic I've been going on about. Another tool in creating a bond between the audience and the family to make us care about them is humor. Diane watches as Steve playfully mimics an Olympic diver while she smokes a joint. And then Steven jumps down and does a before and after joke with his stomach as we hear Diane laugh in the background, a humorous sight gag. It's important to note that one thing the family has is a great deal of chemistry. This is in the effective casting of the actors by the filmmakers. The chemistry between the actors is what generates more sympathy for them in the audience. They are the ideal American family that loves each other and gets along. Who wouldn't want to be like that? And it's this strong identification between audience and Freeling family that is the glue needed to create maximum empathy later on when the terrible events of the story reveal themselves. Casting is so important in horror films. When trying to create a realistic scenario, putting actors together who seem like they belong together goes a long way in getting audiences on board with the scenario. One of the things the film does brilliantly is take everyday neighborhood and household objects and makes them sinister or threatening in some manner. Before, it was the dead bird, then the malfunctioning TV, then the tree, and now we see the clown being illuminated by the lightning, giving it a frightening look. In normal room lighting, the clown doesn't look all that threatening, but the lightning effect completely changes that. Another subtle thing that is used to completely transform a normal, everyday circumstance into something sinister. This is one of Poltergeist's major strengths as a horror film. The next morning at breakfast, Robbie's glass of milk breaks, the bottom dropping out from under it for seemingly no reason. This again establishes, in a very subtle fashion, that there is trouble in paradise, with normally reliable things malfunctioning, and that the parents can't shield their children from what's going to happen. It creates subtle anxiety, and in the same scene, Robbie notices his fork and spoon are bent, also apparently for no reason. Diane watches as the dog barks like crazy at a mark on the wall in their bedroom. The mark is from the previous night when the phantasmagorical spirits shot out of the television and into the wall. Dogs are a very reliable indicator of danger, being able to sense things humans can't. Its crazy barking at the mark is another sign that something is very wrong in this house and is about to get worse. When Steven comes home, he finds Diane having been experimenting with the chairs, investigating their ability to move on their own, another normal household set of objects that are supposed to be reliable and predictable, acting up for seemingly no reason. When it moves across the floor, Diane jumps up and down, elated at what's been happening. This is actually a very clever way Spielberg disarms us, by creating a sense of discovery and joy about these abnormal forces, with Diane's enthusiasm at discovering what is happening. These kinds of things would normally freak people out, but it creates a real character moment for Diane, showing how open-minded she is about the phenomenon. It also creates contrast between her and Steven, who is very worried. This develops a character dynamic that keeps the events interesting. If both Diane and Steven were freaked out about the chairs, it would be boring. Two people having the same reaction is usually the death of drama, and films are less interesting for it. It also creates tension in the minds of the audience, since in the previous scene, they were shown how potentially threatening these spirits are. All of this benign, comforting setup in the first act of Poltergeist is what creates such effective horror later on, because the contrast is so extreme. We care about the Freeling family because they are such warm, funny people who get along and love each other, which is reinforced by their warm, inviting suburban environment. All these tricks are designed to create not only maximum horror later on, but to give Poltergeist more dramatic weight than your average horror movie. If you enjoyed this video, consider hitting the like and subscribe button, as I'll be posting more content in the future. Thanks for watching.